find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh, check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it's the AwesomeCast episode 256. We're talking geeky things, and it's hot and sweaty here in the AM studios. Holy crap, we got all the fans running here. It's July, what, 7th, right? So, yeah, we really need to... You'd think I would learn by now. We got all the fans rolling, and we got the hot pizza, and we got the cold iced coffee going on. I'm big gulping it tonight. Like I said, I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter. With me in the studio, we got everybody in here. First of all, there on your left, if you're on the cameras, or on your left, if you're listening on audio, yes. It doesn't...
Their left or my left?
Hey, if it's audio, it's whatever left they want it to be.
Oh, man.
It's Katie Dudas. I got Kay Dudders on the Twitters.
Hello there.
Expert kitty, Hello Kitty Wrangler, and...
starring in the new movie coming next year.
I want to start giving you guys new names, as like I try to do when we're introducing mayhem people.
Ooh.
So I don't have everybody's here for the most part, so I can't go on like Poughkeepsie, New York, and Texas where cattle roam free or something. So there's that. Also with us on the couch is John Chichilla back in Studio A. I understand Studio B is under renovations.
It's a mess.
It is. Are you, I mean...
Actually converting it. I'm downsizing the tech.
Okay.
Because I've upsized the hardware, so I don't need as much.
does that mean you have bigger hardware or...
No, everything's gotten smaller, right?
Okay.
So I don't have a need as much for the large desk.
Mm-hmm.
And like even some of my like i7 I have i7 tablets.
Yeah.
So I can throw them up on a shelf and they run just fine.
Can we do, we have to do at some point. Can I come over? We just need to do a tour of your tech.
Yeah, when the new overhaul is done, because I used to have a 4-foot wide desk and it kind of looked like your desk, right? With multiple screens everywhere. And
oh, you mean an absolute mess.
Yes.
Yes.
So now, and I had like a 27-inch TV and a 27-inch monitor and all kinds of crap everywhere. And I'm like, okay, now I'm actually virtualizing a bunch of stuff. So with the new MacBook.
You're putting it in the cloud.
Oh, I'm not putting it in the cloud. It's local.
Okay.
But I have.
You're putting it in the Chilla cloud.
Yeah, I'm putting it in my own private cloud. On-prem, and I can actually run, an easy 4 workstations simultaneously on the new MacBook Pro. So I don't need as much of the extra older hardware that I had. I mean, I still had P4s and old Atom-based equipment.
Wow.
Stuff like that.
See, I have to figure out what my bottom line of the Athlon is. Well, we're getting geeky right off the bat. But like generally, I'm like, it has to be a core duo, right? Like that's like, at least for the studio things, but I need X amount of processor to do anything down here. So I kind of need that.
You shouldn't necessarily, if you're just running a hangout, you shouldn't need, like for your client hangouts, you shouldn't need, I don't know how you're still switching that.
Oh, well, the thing is, there's the client is working, plus we have desktop presenters. So not only are we working in Google Hangout, it has to process that. It also has to process the screen grab that goes over the network. And I think that adds a little bit more overhead. I don't know what percentage that is. But we're generally – so I got 3 core duos. I think all – at least 2 of them core duo 2s and a core duo, at least 1, maybe 2. And I think our audio backup – is maybe like a Celeron or actually probably AMD something or other. So, but like today I got a laptop from my mother, and it was like Windows XP, and it was I think it was the first AMD 64s. It is heavy.
Oh,
heavy.
Sure.
I can't remember.
The heat probably coming off of that.
Yes, and I can't remember the last time I looked at the back of a laptop, and that's where all the ports were. Like this is I. Just blown away by this, and so I'm excited to see what we can do with
which
that.
Actually reminds. So I'm now. Thank you for reminding me. Due to the room makeover, I'm actually changing impromptu my awesome thing of the week.
Oh no.
All right, all right. We'll see what that is. We'll see what's going on there. But
so I just heard a spinoff show we need to have. It's AwesomeCast Cribs. Show
yes!
us your tech.
That would be amazing. I love this idea. Well, you didn't catch last week's show idea, did you?
Well, did you see my Thursday tweet?
You did see your Thursday tweet.
I'm going to keep them going until you start a show.
Please, let's do it. I've been really bad about getting awesome chat people every week, so maybe we'll just do this, you know? Okay, how many shows do we have for Wrestling Mayhem Show? It's now time for us to do this for the Awesome Cast. Let's just push the vertical on this show and this concept and do everything that we can, and I love this. I love this. Now I want, if you've got a crib and you're in the Pittsburgh area, you want us to see your tech crib. Hit us up on the Twitter at AwesomeCast or whatever social media, and we'll talk about that. I love this idea. Anyways,
I think that's going to be one of those things that you're going to have to almost splice in. Because you're not going to cut live to that, are you?
No, absolutely not. No, this is thing of like, well, I'm guessing I would go to somebody's house and film it.
Right.
You know, I mean, even if I just do like the iPhone thing or something.
You should.
Don't you remember,
Chris? I do. One thing, we should green screen my floor and you can make like the whole thing be transparent to the second level. That'd be awesome. We could just special effects the hell out of it.
Oh, that's a good idea. Oh man. Anyways, this is the Awesome Cast. You can check out everything at awesomecast.net and you can find all the links on all the social medias and the podcasty ways, video and audio formats. We're all over the place. Please subscribe to us, especially on the iTunes. Even if you're not even listening to us on iTunes, it helps greatly through all the podcatchers to do that. We have been around for 5 years and I know people are listening to this. I have people that I'm like, hey, I don't know if you ever heard of us, but I'd like you to be on the show. And they're like, oh, I listen. It's been really incredible lately. But yet nobody has reviewed us on iTunes for AwesomeCast. So I'd like to see that change. Please, AwesomeCasters, get out there right now. Download the new iTunes, listen to some Beat Music and Beats One Radio, and give us a review for AwesomeCast. And let us know what you think of that, and it'll help. Maybe out of nowhere we'll get on new and noteworthy, since we'll just pop out of nowhere. So please do that. Help out the show, and you can also help out if you're digging the show, if you're getting value out of the show and the five other shows we're about to start. Apparently, please go to patreon.com/awesomecast. Become our boss. Contribute to the show, and we've had a really good run of people doing the same thing over on Wrestling Mayhem Show. I like this to be a user supported one too as well. So please do that to help us continue the awesomeness. So let's get into our awesome things of the week. I gotta go first on this one, guys. I mean, we can't not start the show with giant robots actually fighting each other. Now, and I know there's a video that's been going around. I don't know if you guys have seen this. The robot fails, where it's been like bipedal robots that just don't work and are running into walls and falling out of golf carts and stuff like that.
It's like the scene from Iron Man 2, where Tony Stark shows like all the different countries that are trying to rebuild the Iron Man armor.
It is, except more autonomous, like not people in this. This video actually more reminds me of that, especially the Japanese guys in this. I did find the epic fails one, but anyways, so that's loading. There are at least two companies or makers or something creating robots.
Large
battle-style robots. Basically, mechs. We can just call these mechs. Mech Warrior, that's basically what we're going for here. We're at that point, people. This is the future. And to the point where you're like, that's awesome, but almost not even batting an eye that it exists. Be like, of course it exists. We have, like, automatic cars and stuff. Welcome to Back to the Future 2. We don't have the hoverboard. We have everything else you ever wanted in 2015. But anyways, so first of all, we have the company Megabot MK 2, and they're actually a great video with them wearing American flag capes and fire going off behind them and everything. But they have a big robot that looks like they really retrofitted this onto some work equipment with treads and everything. There's giant, I'll see if I can skip ahead here for you guys on video. It's retrofitted with giant paintball guns, like Gatling paintball guns. And it looks freaking serious. It actually takes two people to operate. There's actually an operator and a gunner in this thing. It's ridiculous. So, and there's some shots there of it just destroying cars with paintballs.
Wow.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. So, there's another company, and I will not pronounce it right, so we'll just leave it at that. It's Japanese. The Karatis. It is a one-man operated. And like I said, this one reminded me of the Iron Man even more so, right? Like, he's sitting in there. I mean, this looks like the behemoth at the end of Iron Man 1. To a point. This is real. So basically, a Megabot, the paintball gun guys, and the Japanese one actually shoots, not beanies, what was the one? The Red Rider from, what do they call
those?
BBs. Yeah, like just serious BBs, right?
Like plastic or metal?
I think metal. I'm not entirely sure, but it's a little more lethal, I think. So they were challenged, and this is a Japanese company, and they accepted the challenge with the caveat that no guns. They want melee. Because the Japanese guy, he's like, well, big guns, that's such an American thing to do, because you put big guns on everything. I want to beat your metal into the ground.
What does the winner get? Is this like...
I don't think there's anything other than bragging rights at this point.
I figured it was going to be like Fast and Furious. They're battling for pink slips. I want to see winner takes all the robots home.
Oh, that'd be great. That would be great. But you got to think, they spent all this time making a robot. Now they have to destroy it.
I thought that was part of the Japanese thing, was they were reluctant because they didn't. This was the, isn't it the first one?
Yeah, it probably
is.
I
read somewhere it's like the first one they've actually completed. So for it to get destroyed, potentially destroyed, it's their only one.
Look, there's Tess in there with like the hand that works and everything. This is incredible.
So are they going to modify the ones then?
I think
they don't look like they're really meant for hand-to-hand.
No, combat. No. I think they have a year to do this. Okay. They say, we will meet in 1 year. It very is like a movie at this point. It's incredible. It's absolutely incredible. This is apparently for real. We have robots. We have mechs. And I don't even know what to say about that at this point. It's just incredible. There you go. I mean, they were like battle bots. Well, that's on like NBC or something now, right? Mm-hmm. That kind of caught me by surprise, because I remember it being the thing that like Mick Foley hosted on Sci-Fi Channel back in the day. But hey, okay. So there you go. Giant robots. Check it out. Check out the videos if you get a chance here. We got it tweeted over on the social medias as well. So
I'd be nervous to be in the bot. If we're doing hand-to-hand combat, I don't know if I
want to
be in the bot.
Yep. Right. They also have to like formulate, what are the rules of this? Like, how do you win, you know? Or does this just become the Karate Kid?
You sweep the leg.
Sweep the leg? Only one of them has legs, so it has an advantage. So, Kenny, what do you think of this?
It's amazing. There's rules like no hitting in the face or the genitals or...
I hope this becomes an Olympic sport.
Wouldn't that be
like
great?
Everyone sends their robot to the Olympics to compete? But no. But in all seriousness, the one thing that worries me is, what are they going to make them where they're remote controlled, so there's no pilot?
Well, one of them, I think the Japanese one actually does run off of a PC, like a laptop inside the machine. So you really could automate that. It'll probably be a little harder for the one that takes two people. So,
but I'm guessing you'd only need one person if there were no guns.
True. Mm-hmm. Well, he's the gunner, so
yeah.
Unless that includes operating the arms, maybe like aiming and such. Mm-hmm. So if you need something to, this guy moves a thing, this guy operates this stuff, it could be.
I think I always change them like Nerf shooters. They just have Nerf gun and targets.
Pew. Accuracy. I don't know. We'll see. 1 year from now, we'll be talking about this again, I'm sure. So, Katie, what do you got?
Porn!
From robots to porn, we have it all here on the AwesomeCast.
Guess what? Porn has finally hit virtual reality for both the Oculus and the Samsung Gear.
Finally, VR. What took it so long?
Well, it's part of the Oculus's terms of service is not in their store is not creating pornographic type stuff.
Okay.
So
you can watch a threesome in virtual reality if you know where to look. That's the headline on this thing.
Mm-hmm. Nasty America. Which is the
of
name.
Course.
The name of the, I guess.
Naughty America.
Naughty America. I'm sorry. Nasty. I like nasty better. Naughty America.
Chilla's correcting on the porn.
Yeah.
Well, I was just reading the article.
It's two chicks same time is the name of it. So two chicks same time. You can either have a man or a woman at the center of the action. Your choice. And I had no idea that there was an actual Reddit feed for Oculus NSFW. So in case you're looking for something exciting to look at, there is a Reddit feed, just straight Oculus NSFW.
We will not be bringing that up on the video feed here on YouTube.
Yeah. So yeah, so you can be part of a threesome without actually having to be part of a threesome.
Oh, this is free?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Do you want to be the man or the woman?
Huh.
So this is kind of the first major step. I mean, everything we know with technology is based around porn and the proliferation of porn.
Well, there's actually an interesting book called Sex, Bombs, and Burgers, and it's about how all technology that we have today and we'll probably have in our lifetime is all based on technology that was developed by the military, by fast food industry, or by the porn industry.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a really good book. Catch it if you can.
Oh, wait a minute. Starring Nikki Benz, Jacqueline Taylor, and now you. So if you're
and it's just an MPEG.
It's what?
It's just an MPEG video.
Mm-hmm. Oh, geez. So it's just for watching.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like you probably just snag it, and it's that weird double thing. So it's on the Oculus. What keeps you from putting it on?
It's on Samsung.
It's on Samsung.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and it's probably doing something specific for the Gear VR, so you couldn't just pop it into like the Google Cardboard. So.
Mm-hmm.
Well.
You're really considering this.
Well,
like not you're considering this, but you're like really wrapping your head around
I'm
this
really
thing.
Wrapping my head around it, because how does it work? Is it just going to be a video?
Basically. I mean, you want interactive porn is what you're looking for, right?
Well, not just that, but I'm thinking, like, if I look behind me, the video is not going to have...
No.
Like, I'm thinking the whole VR situation should be where I can look behind me. And if I don't want to look at the two people in the porn, I can look at the
back. Why did you download it?
But I feel like the whole point of it is just set stagnant, and it's not making good use of the actual, what part of virtual reality? To me, it's just giving you like a three-dimensional.
But the thing is you're not thinking of the package deals. You can set this up now, because now you have this here in your eyes, and you sell it with a doll or something of some sort, and now you have a whole experience.
You think about it, you don't have to have the real doll because you just need something that feels right, and
yeah.
Why are we wrapping our heads around this thing?
Just stuff a t-shirt and go to town.
There's a North American tour?
Oh, Naughty America.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh, it's just a thing for all their sites.
Oh.
Nah. The URL's NA tour.
Very nice.
See what VR user... Ah, this is interesting.
Yeah.
Well, on that...
Well, this could be you. There's a picture.
Well, and it's... But see how it's, like, fish-eyed? Like, that's where I'm wondering. Like, I'm thinking... Where I'm thinking about this is, right, just like I said, anything we get usually ends up coming from porn, military, or fast food. Like, how long is it before... If I want to watch a football game, I can watch it sitting in the middle of the field.
But that's also going to require like very, very specialized cameras to do the movement live. And this is, and I know this is something.
Well, I don't think it, but here's where I think you're wrong. Because if you have a 360 degree rig.
Yeah, like the Google one with the GoPros, right?
You're just filming a bandwidth thing.
Because you have to stream, regardless if you're looking at it or not. That video has to stream to you.
Yeah.
I would think. So
do it like 720p.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm not saying do it in 4K.
No, no, and I don't even know what these are capable on the
But like
Lexus.
that's where wouldn't it be cool to have these on?
Right.
And like watch a hockey game sitting at center ice. Or walk around an instant replay.
Yeah.
Like that's that's why I'm wondering, like, the whole point of this
is more stagnant. But it has to be captured.
Right.
In the first place.
And this isn't captured, I guess.
Yeah.
And that's where I want them to take this, right? I want them to take this, and I'm not a huge sports buff by any means, but I want them to take it where you see those 360-degree rotation views in, like, The Matrix and in the Avengers Age of Ultron.
Right.
Like, let me walk through that scene. That's what I want. And we talked about it for selling houses, right?
Right.
Like, to me, this is the first step in I can walk around inside of a movie.
So more of like an augmented reality type.
Well, no, because it wouldn't be augmented because I'm
immersed. I'm sorry, I'm still in the porn world.
But even in the porn world, right? It wouldn't be augmented.
Okay, never mind.
Because it wouldn't be overlaid in the room I'm in.
Ooh, there's
which would be even more interesting. That's like, there was that movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger where they kept bringing him back to life or cloning him. But no, see, like, that's where I want them to take this, where I can walk around within a sporting event or a movie or a video game. And to me, this then takes video games more to the live action type video. So I don't know. I find it interesting of what they're doing. I think the applications are endless for this. Not just, I think it'll go far beyond the porn industry.
No, but as usual, they're the ones pushing the envelope and getting, you know, that's what happened with Google Glass. They didn't allow this kind of stuff. And then it went away.
Well, and I think one of your topics right before we do my awesome thing of the week.
Before we settle things down a little bit here.
And to take it one step further, like, look at, if you're talking about just the stagnant camera, right? I'm guessing you put the Meet the GoPro Hero 4, which is the tiny camera. Throw that on Sidney Crosby's helmet and let me put on the Gear VR.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like that's step one. And then step two, okay, let me walk around the ice. I don't know. I think it's pretty cool. I mean, you could have handicapped people experiencing more things. Like I said, I think the applications are endless.
Awesome.
See?
Awesome.
Porn, very important. That's all we learned.
Chilla, what very, very subtle, not weird or giant or sexy thing are you talking about this week?
So one of the things that we were talking about my room overhaul, and one of the problems I have is I actually have a lot of USB hubs merely for just the charging aspect. Because if you ever look at like the charge bricks that come with a phone or with a tablet or with anything USB related, and you look at a surge protector. I don't know about anyone else, but I can never get more than like 3 on a 6-port surge protector.
Yeah. It depends on which way the surge protector is too.
Right.
Right.
So the one device this wasn't originally my awesome pick of the week, but I remember that I had this out there because I'm actually going to order 3 of these. They're only $15 a piece, but it's a 5-port USB charging station. Go to the first. That's the second.
Okay. No problem. Not a problem.
It's my fault. Changing last minute. No, it's 4.5 inches in height and 1.5 inches in width.
Ooh.
It puts out 2.4 amps. So if you look at the size or the sides of your bricks and look at what they're outputting, it can put out a total of 6 amps.
So no problem charging iPads or anything
on this?
No
problem charging iPads. It does have a, it can check the voltage going through it, making sure it's not overloading. It does have a 5-foot, 2-pronged power cable, so you can put it a decent distance. So think about this, and look at the way they fitted their power cable with the way it's rounded and looks like a normal everyday cord, right? Mm-hmm. You can fit 6 of these on a 6-port surge protector, buddy. So you could charge up 30 devices simultaneously,
wow,
which is something I could actually probably hit in the realm of possibility with all the devices I have. I think I'm buying one of these, two of these for my house and one of these for work. So to me, it's an easy answer for me to charging a bunch of USB devices, and for $15, you can't pass it up.
Why the heck not? $15, holy crap! Is it on Amazon? I am adding that to my wish list. All right. So you have a secondary one here too.
So I do have a secondary one. This actually, I saw this either late last week, early this week, and now I lost it. Proxy Ham. So our friends over at DEF CON Hacker Conference are going to be talking about a device that they made, and I think it's actually powered either off of an Arduino or it's a Raspberry Pi, sorry. It's a Raspberry Pi. It actually has three antennas on it. One of the antennas will pick up Wi-Fi in the location and log into that Wi-Fi, and the other two will actually then retransmit that Wi-Fi up to 2.5 miles under ideal conditions. The cool thing is, on the opposite end, all you need is the little receiver device and an RJ45 cable, and it plugs right into your laptop. Or, think about it, you could then power another Wi-Fi repeater on the other end off of this thing.
Hmm.
I'm guessing this might be something kind of like what they're doing at the hardware store, where they built out like the point-to-point network.
Right.
On the hill. It does use the 900 megahertz frequency, so those of you who are familiar with 900 megahertz and walkie-talkies and cordless phones, if either one of those things are still a thing, baby monitors, whatnot, it will cause interference with them. And one of the reasons they're talking about this at DEF CON, right, is that you could take this, put it in a coffee shop, tape it to the bottom of a table where no one's going to see it, as long as it has a wall plug, and then go 2.5 miles away and torrent and hack and do whatever you want. And when they finally trace you to where you're supposed to be at, you're going to be sitting in this coffee shop. So I think it's applications could be definitely nefarious. Where I could definitely see this being nice is, say, we live 2.5 miles, within 2.5 miles of each other, and you up your network to the Verizon Fios 100 up, 100 down, and we split your bill.
Mm-hmm.
And then I have this thing sitting in my house.
Oh,
and we
that's devastating.
Put our networks together.
That's like, if you're the classic, like, the family lives on the same blocks.
Yes.
You know, I mean, that's, you would do that. Right. You would basically do that.
So I could see this being used, like I said, for both nefarious purposes, but also I know people that I work with that have built the coffee can antennas on the back of the their Linksys Blue, the old WRT routers.
Right.
The 2.4 gigahertz routers, and they built coffee can antennas and joined the two together,
mm-hmm,
and their actual houses were failovers for each other's home internet. So if one person's house went dark from Comcast, the other house picked up via
nice
Verizon.
Especially if you were like, my Comcast never freaking works and you don't have a choice, then
right
there you go. That'd be nice for, like, if you have satellite. And what's the range on this thing, you say?
2.5 miles.
Two and a half miles
under optimum per conditions.
Okay.
But yes.
Okay. Because I'm just thinking about, like, what I grew up where, like, the family was, like, my dad's house, my cousin, my grandma, my aunt. Like, that's how close we were, mm-hmm, along this road, right? And I'm just like, could we have all shared the same internet? Presuming you could get internet there, which was the first thing. Again, they have satellite. That's it. That's it. That's all you can do. But I'm trying to problem solve this thing. But Anyways, real cool. And I do have the question now, and I'm hoping to get an answer from Hardware Store about that, too. So hopefully get an update in a little bit. Awesome. So please tell us, what is your awesome thing of the week as well, on the social medias, at AwesomeCast, on the Twitters, as well as Facebook and Google+, and everything else. So, hey, first of all, we like pizza around here, right? I mean, if you popped in, you see a bit of a pizza party, especially when everybody's in here. Oh, I thought you grabbed it. So, friends of the show, Slice on Broadway, they're helping feeding the people that are coming during their dinner time here.
I don't know what happened to the rest of that pizza.
I have no idea. To the podcast studio, they're helping us out, helping to feed the people, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with fine pepperoni pizza. You can check them out at sliceonbroadway.com. They're down here in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, right along the T line in Beachview, or down there in Main Street of Carnegie, PA. Right. Awesome locations, awesome people, awesome pizza. Go check them out, sliceonbroadway.com or PGH_slice on the Twitters, Slice on Broadway on Facebook and the Instagram. What's going on over there?
Like, it knows what the box sounds like.
Yes, he does. All you have to do is move the box and he'll hear it. And what you don't know, he's actually, because I know this because whenever I'm leaving, he's waiting for me at the top of the landing. And he's just perched, listening for the box. Staying out of the way, and just rolled down here. So that dog got ribs this weekend, so I don't want to hear it from him. So, anyways, and with that, let's go check out what happened this week on Sorgatron Media.
It's time, I think, Sawtooth have an intern in the Pittsburgh Underground. Sorgatron here. Since you ain't come down to visit, since you ain't gonna snort no cat dander with Sawtooth. Sawtooth needs assistance in other ways.
This is my first Gateway 2000.
Wow.
3633DX. I had the math coprocessor.
But if you go to analytics.pinterest.com, log into your account, you can see this amazing dashboard. It kind of reminds me a bit of what you get for Insight on Pages.
What's happening is Red Bull is teaming up with Activision for Destiny, creating a DLC for the game.
Does it give you wings?
No. Actually, it might. Who knows?
Last night I went to Dependable Drive-In, which is a place that I've heard about probably for about a decade at this point, and for whatever reason, just never made it to.
But yeah, air sex is the greatest sporting spectacle in the world. So it started off as like a small idea, like a parody of an air guitar show, and it just grew from there. It just snowballed. It was... because we saw an opportunity to grow a project, we were like, let's ride this thing and see how it goes.
Oh no, my camera has the follow my face feature, and even though I'm sitting still, it thinks I'm not.
It just did it.
I'll fix this manually, Sorg.
Oh no!
Oh, it didn't follow your face that time.
There we go.
All right. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, where we don't understand technology here. Chachi Plays for Kids is coming back again, the 24-hour game-a-thon for youth arts programs in Pittsburgh. August 7th and 8th at the Toonzeum, or join us live at ChachiPlays.com. Find out how you can make a difference too and donate today. ChachiPlays.com.
Up, down, down, left, right, B-A, B-A, start!
Yeah! And check out all of the shows, SorgatronMedia.com. We got a lot of stuff going on, and some new things. We actually got a new show that's not in there. It's audio only, Fishing Without Bait, a little mindful kind of thing. The Power Hour. We're getting back to basics, man. We're getting back to audio only with a couple of shows and having fun with that. So we got a few stories. Jeez, where do we start, guys? So do you want to do your rundown at the end?
I don't know what you
want to say. Let's
Sure, you can do whatever.
You know what?
You can set that up for the newsletter.
I can set what? Oh.
Whoa.
Oh. Okay. We'll hold on to that. Well, I'm excited about... Well, okay, first of all, I don't know if I'm excited about this yet, but Xbox Music. Do you know anybody that does Xbox Music? Okay, Krause probably does it, right?
I don't know if he...
Is he that into it? I mean...
I don't know if he has a subscription... Because that doesn't come with Xbox. I don't think that comes with like a gold subscription.
No. You have to pay for it. It's a full-on subscription. So, but anyway, so this has been around for a bit, and then I think like the Windows version meshed with it, and now it's all Xbox Music. Even if you have a Windows computer, and that's how you listen to it, I think there's an app for it on Android and on iOS. So they just went over a bit of a rebranding here as we're heading into Windows 10. They're going to Xbox Music is now called Groove as they recycle and rebrand. This is kind of classic Microsoft, because how many times has MSN been rebranded into something else, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, so it's not, especially in the wake of Apple Music. And it's basically the same as what you expect here. It's $9.99 a month or $99 a year. They don't have pricing yet for the UK or Europe yet. So I don't think it's as widely available generally as Apple Music, I think, ends up. But I don't know. What do you think about this? Is this do they have a chance? It feels like Microsoft just has these services because at this point, and they can put the money into it.
I feel like we're going to see, as Windows Phone 10 hits and Windows 10 hits,
right,
and the next Xbox OS comes out, I think you're going to see there's going to be an aha moment, and you're going to say, wow, like Microsoft got it. They finally understood what Apple's been doing since the dawn of Apple, with the integration. And I think all these are going to start to converge and make sense. To your point, I definitely agree. It seems like right now it seems like a Me Too thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like everything's very segregated. And we're even see that a little in Apple's Music, right? Between Match and everything else. But I think they do definitely have a chance. I think it's going to all hinge on how everything works out with Windows 10. And I think it could actually drive people to the platform. Not necessarily music and just by itself, but when you start to bundle all of these things together, and we've had the discussion on the show, right? Yeah, bundling Xbox Live with the Xbox Music, with your Office 365 subscription, getting an unlimited OneDrive account,
mm-hmm.
All of that, all of those topics, or all of those packages together, I think is where they start to make the difference, and how they integrate, and not only how they integrate, but how they go cross-platform. I wouldn't have picked Groove Music Pass, because guess what else? Why didn't they just call it Zune Music Pass? But
is that what that evokes for
just
you?
Just call it Groove.
Is that really what that evokes for you, though?
Yeah, because I remember Zune Music Pass. That was their
okay.
thing for
the
Zune.
Okay, oh, it's the Music mm-hmm. Pass that you don't like.
Yeah, I don't like the Music okay. Pass. I like Groove. Groove was actually a thing that Microsoft had right around 2007 that was going to be a workflow automation thing for SharePoint that I don't think ever took off. So there has been a Microsoft Groove in the past. To me, this makes more sense for the word Groove.
Yeah.
But I think I look at all these music catalogs and I personally, as a consumer, I don't want to see a bunch of different company or all the different companies putting on a bunch of different exclusives.
Right.
I would rather see everyone having almost an identical catalog, and it just depends on what makes more sense for me to have.
So it's you want it kind of more based on features. Like you
features
can say,
are, right.
Apple Music has the ability, like you know, say the music match, and the fact that I can you know say Siri play this, and the Beats One Radio is their differentiator versus Google does this mood thing that I think is really cool versus Pandora is just kind of everywhere anyways. Is that kind of what you're looking at? Like,
well,
like,
I'm looking at it like that, and I'm also looking at it like maybe it makes more sense because I'm a Prime customer to use Amazon and have their catalog because it bundles better with what I'm already doing.
Right.
Or maybe if I was an Office 365 person, getting the discount on Groove makes more sense for me.
Right.
Or because I'm already an Apple customer and it's easy to hook up to my iTunes account that I already have,
you know,
I might as well use Music.
This is like it reminds me of when cable started bundling everything together with internet and telephone, except it doesn't piss me off as much.
When I look at it almost like the radio, right?
Yeah.
All the radios have the same, pretty much have the same access to the same music catalog.
Mm-hmm.
It's just what they play.
Mm-hmm.
To me, this is, I have access to the entire catalog and I can pick what I play.
So, Like, you need, didn't we talk about Playmos or something that really brought all those together a bit?
I don't remember.
Or maybe that was the one that ran off of YouTube. I thought there was one that kind of conjoined things. Like, we need something that just, like, puts these services together and you don't have any holes. I'm starting to see it. I'm starting to notice albums that aren't there on Apple Music, for instance. And, you know, I have kind of a sort of interesting, obscure taste in music that I go to a gathering for. So I was looking up some of the old albums by one of the artists, and it's not there. And it's just not there. And now I'm thinking, I was like, well, maybe I should do iTunes Music, you know, because I'm addicted to, you know, saying, hey, play this Siri over the last week. I'm pretty sure that's something I'm probably going to end up paying for, even though I get it free from Google Music, right? So I don't know.
Well, that's where I think you could conjoin the two, right? You can do upload your own music into Drive and then have the Apple Music on the side, and how they work together is what's going
to
be.
Yeah, that's the thing, and they don't talk to each other. Versus if you do your iTunes Match, you have all your stuff in here filling the gaps along with listening to new music over on Apple Music.
But to your point, you have to then do Match, and we running on.
Yeah, I think
10%
we're
backup power there.
I don't know what that was.
There's a storm coming.
There is a storm coming.
Did we just have a brownout?
I don't know.
I'm glad I got these on a. None of the computers went that aren't on backup, so. That was really
might have
weird.
Been a slight surge.
Yeah. We'll see how this goes, guys.
But I don't even remember what we were talking about now. Oh, but now you're going to have to pay for Match and for Apple Music, which I think that's
right.
I think they should make it one package.
I kind of agree with you, but I kind of like the idea of set and forget it with the iTunes Match. I'm more prone to do that. And then I don't have to worry about it for a year. Just to be able to call up my music with Siri is almost worth it to me to drop $25 a year.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's just, I just drive around.
But you would do music and Match, right?
I don't know. Because turns out Beats One Radio, not exclusive to paying for it.
Right.
I understand. So, and iTunes music stations were already there. I'm not entirely sure. Well, of course, Apple Music means I can go look up a track and play it. And I'm doing that now, but the things I'm calling for are things I only already have in my collection. So what would I be paying for at that point? I think if nothing else, after these 3 months, just to still play the game that I am right now, I will probably be paying for iTunes Match and using their streaming just in general for everything else. And just until the ads piss me off. But it's interesting. And I keep hearing about how Tidal's not doing well either. And the reasons for that. Tidal, if you don't know, is the one that's higher quality, more money for the already rich artists, and just completely botched the launch on that one. So it's interesting to see. Interesting to see. All right. I'm sure we'll be talking plenty more. Chilla, have you spent any more time with Apple Music?
I have not.
Or Katie, have you signed up for it? No? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Well, if you do, I want to kind of touch base and see how you guys are doing with that then. So, all right. This is me. This is all me. GoPro Hero 4 session. I don't have a GoPro, but man, I want one. And I may have to target this thing. I was actually having a conversation. We're trying to figure out, we have access to two GoPros and potentially a drone. And we're looking to use them at a wrestling show. So we're going to have some fun footage coming up here soon. But the Hero 4 session, a tiny camera with big shoes to fill. It's nice. It's nice. We're talking 1080p, 60 frames a second. Those are your big numbers there. It's not doing 4K. And it's weighing in at, oh, there goes the power again. It's weighing in at $399, which is the same price for the silver as well. So new GoPro. These things look fun. They're using these at WWE shows, I noticed. They have like one of these just set up on the aisle, just looking at the entranceway to make sure nobody's in the way of the pyro, for instance. So there's a new one out there for you guys to get. Also, Google-owned Waze launches Ride With carpooling app on Android. I'm a Waze user. Katie, you are too. I beep at you all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And how's that Terminator going
for
you?
Oh, I love it. It's so much fun.
there's a Terminator voice package with a new movie on Waze, so go download so Arnold can direct you to where you need to go. Did you get to the point where there's a hazard on the road? Get down!
Yes. Yes, I had that right away.
It's a little disarming. but anyway, so this is them kind of reaching into the ride-sharing side of things. They're actually going to be testing this in Tel Aviv. If those don't know, Waze is actually an Israeli company, if I have that right. So, which is, you know, it doesn't feel like it's a foreign company at all. Like, you're just like, and it's owned by Google now, of course. So, but they're going to do a private beta test in Tel Aviv for the carpool concept. So Google getting in pretty much, it seems more carpool instead of taxi replacement that Uber and Lyft have become, though.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're kind of getting back to basics when it comes to this thing. But I don't know. What do you guys think? Have you guys ever done an Uber or anything like that?
I have not. I know a lot of people that do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't necessarily have a need. Mm-hmm. Quite often, mm-hmm. I don't travel that much. That being said, so here's where I run into... I use public transportation, and public transportation and where I live is faster because it doesn't get caught up with the other
because
traffic
we happen
of the cars.
To have a train accessible to us because we are lucky in this corridor in the South Hills.
So if I lived in the East, I would definitely jump on this.
Mm-hmm.
If it came to Pittsburgh, traffic coming out of the East is ridiculous.
Yes.
Oh gosh.
Yes. The
if
worst.
You're in Pittsburgh, you know what I'm talking about. You pretty much just can't get there from here.
Granted, in some cities, you will probably find the traffic laughable in comparison. But for us, it is the thing.
I would hope that people would use this. And mm-hmm. I would hope that... I hope this goes over well. Because I think there's demand for this. And it could definitely be used in most larger metropolitan areas.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Even smaller metropolitan areas. I think something like this could definitely...
Like a Columbus or something.
Yes.
Yeah. Certainly. So it's going to get crowded out there, and we'll see what happens as... of course, there's all the crazy stuff happening with Uber in France right now with the taxi protests and everything. So speaking of robots, I wanted to talk about this, sort of. Anki Overdrive blends robotic racing with video game hooks. So I've seen this before, so... This basically, like, your, at first glance, it looks like the old, like, car, what do you call them, box
slot.
Cars? Slot cars.
Yeah.
Slot cars, yeah.
I have slot cars. I can't wait till Christopher's old enough. They're up in the attic.
Well, by that time, he's got these things. There's a track, and there's, you know, I've seen older versions of this on Twitter and stuff. They've been playing with those. And you use your iPhone to control it, and there's not actually a slot. It knows where the track is. So that's how it operates. Now, they seem to be adding a video game concept to it a little bit. So not only do you have the racing, but there's also, like, characters, battles, and you shoot at the other... I'm thinking like a laser tag kind of thing.
Well, I don't think it's necessarily a laser tag type thing. I mean, it's mm-hmm. all run off the phone, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, laser tag as in, like, there's no actual interaction, interaction, but there's, like, a digital... Oh, you got shot.
Right. The first four cars had this capability.
Right.
The first racetrack had this capability where you could have guns. I think the electro pulse that would slow down or maybe it was the sonic beam one. So they did have some of this in the revision one, but revision one kind of just had a round, like, typical racetrack.
Right.
It was not nearly
so
this cold.
It's a more complex track and everything.
Yeah. I only saw the large oval track mm-hmm. on the first one. But even Leo Laporte last year on New Year's Eve, they brought this into the studio. And he talked about you can put it in kind of a race and fight mode. Or dual mode,
mm-hmm.
where it would the cars kind of shoot at each other and whatnot.
That's awesome. Of course, they got a sweet unrealistic promo video for this. So it's kind of like this, but imagine all that stuff's just invisible, right? So.
Well, and I think what should happen is some of that should kind of be on your phone or tablet.
Wouldn't it be great if they did an AR where there's a camera on your phone looking at it, and when you see your car, you see all the weapons on it? You could do that.
I don't see why they couldn't do that.
There's no reason they couldn't do that.
Mm-mm. Because the controller, your phone, knows where the car is at all times on the track.
Because
it knows where the track is.
Mm-hmm. You just need you need that visual piece, like whatever that is that makes the car, the pointer at the car in NASCAR work at every camera.
Oh, and they're finally making it. Sounds like they're finally making it cross platform.
Nice.
So as long as your Android device has Bluetooth LE.
Okay. And it was iPhone only before?
Yeah. Remember they showed this at one of the announcements. I can't remember if it was WWDC
right.
2 years ago.
Right.
Or if it was the iPad. They showed it at an announcement. And they had the creators come out and talk about it. And, then they started selling the kits in the Apple store.
Awesome. Tell me about Tinder. What's happening with Tinder?
So, you know, we're already swiping left. And I'm sad because I could not find the article, but there is also a Tinder. There is a new, I don't even know what it's called, like some sort of watch or something that measures your heart rate whenever you're using Tinder to see whether or not you should. Yeah. So I got to find that one for next
week.
Is it the
leaf? Did you see our leaf from last
week?
Yeah. It even tracks other lady things.
All the lady things. I know.
Yes,
I was sad.
Yes.
I missed all your lady things. Tinder, now, you know, you're swiping left and swiping right, and a celebrity shows up, and you're like, this can't be so-and-so. And, well, now they're going to verify check marks, just like Twitter.
Oh, wow.
So you're going to be like, oh, this is that famous
person.
So
you can hook up with a celebrity? Is that what's happening here?
Yeah.
Wow.
Because they're Hillary Duff, I know, did a whole music video of her dates on Tinder. And
I can't imagine that. Like really, they're just, like... But then again, just to be a celebrity trying to date has to be horrible to begin with, you know? But, okay.
Yeah, celebrity and notable people.
You do kind of need that, because how many people can just put a picture of so-and-so and be like, oh, I'm completely, I just look like this dude or something. I don't know.
So yeah, so now you can date a celebrity. Or at least know you're dating a real celebrity, I guess. I don't know.
There you go. What if I'm internet famous? What happens there?
It depends on what part of the internet. I mean, if you're YouTube famous.
All right. New Steve Jobs trailer out this week, a little more extended. I feel like we're going to... I'm going to go watch it. I mean, I'm excited for this more or less in the same vein, just on the subject alone as... I don't know why this didn't work the way it was supposed to. As the Facebook movie, The Social Network. I don't know. Are you guys into this? Did you guys see the new trailer and see how the depictions are? I mean, Seth Rogen as Waz is really kind of weird to me. Mm-hmm. Still,
I did not check out the trailer. I'm not gonna lie.
Okay. Did you even see the teaser before?
I can fake it.
You can fake it. There's a little bit of it right there. We see apples. There's, you know,
there's the old iMac.
That's the old iMac. Yes. That's good. We got one of those sitting over there. There's Seth Rogen as Watts.
I'm not buying the
Fassbender as Jobs. I mean, I don't know. What do you think about that?
I don't know.
The very interesting, the weird thing is there's this, I forget the name of her name, but there's a lady in this. Hey, there's a lady in this. But the conversation has been, nobody knows who the heck she is. Like, this is based on the Jobs book.
Is that Kate Winslet's character?
Kate Winslet's character, which seems, according to the trailer, has a pretty prominent role in this, yet was never really spoken about in the books and any biographies or anything like that. So and I think, you know, people know who she is and they've been able to place her, but as part of that narrative, how have they kind of added her on there? So, but it'll be interesting to see. I'm more excited about this than the abysmal Ashton Kutcher movie. You have to be a bad movie for me to not like it. And that was pretty much along those lines. So, but that's coming out, I think, this fall, if I'm correct. So, if you like Sorkin stuff, that's probably going to be good for you. He didn't direct it, but definitely a writer on that. So lots of walking around and camera follows, I'm sure.
Hmm.
From that, I there was an article I tweeted out earlier this week. So you're thinking about flying your drone through fireworks for 4th of July. And the curious part, and to talk about, you know, hey, you should consider this, FAA regulations, etc. And then I'm sitting there on the north side watching the fireworks over by PNC Park, and I see a drone taking pictures of the fireworks.
Mm-hmm.
So these little green lights and moving around. I'm like, okay, all right, what's this about? And I was following that more than the fireworks a bit. Did you see that?
Oh, yeah.
Where you were at? You were over on, I forgot, you were on top of freaking Carnegie Science Center. That's awesome.
That was amazing, by the way.
And you saw the drone as well?
Oh, yeah. You guys are going to be like, yeah.
I wonder if it was official or a rogue drone or something. It was keeping its distance pretty good.
Yeah, so. It wasn't, because it looped out my way, so it definitely probably looped out your way. It's pretty far distance because it came over top of us.
It came over top of the Big Heart place, the building right beside PNC Park, and then like kind of went up the river a bit.
Mm-hmm.
So, I
just assumed it was Dave DeShello.
I had somebody else that said, yeah, I'm completely going to get my drone out there. And I'm like, yeah, I saw someone on the north side. He's like, I'm not that crazy. So I love it. It seems like I was like, I need to get a drone. But now it's like having a boat. You just get a friend with a drone.
We haven't done very well finding a friend with a boat yet.
No, not very good with that. But I actually know a guy. I know a guy. But, I don't want to ask him. Be like, dude, let's do this. But, you know. Anyways. So, social media... Oh, wait, no. Before we get to that, Amazon. Chilla, yeah. I know you've been following this Amazon thing.
I'm super excited about this, and it's... The thing that worries me is it's right before my vacation.
Oh, no.
So
you're going to have a stack of boxes when you come back?
Or am I going to have enough money to still go on vacation? I'm going to go on vacation and not be able to do anything.
Yeah.
I am super, super excited, and I don't want to steal your news story, so... I'll let you cover.
No, go for it. I think you're.
This, I think, is going to be, and I'm trying to find your link. There it is. Because I had.
But it's called Prime Day. It's the 20th anniversary of Amazon. Wow, they're going to have a global shopping event on July 15th,
and I didn't
which
realize,
may be a payday for a lot of people actually. So it works out.
I didn't realize they were 20 years old.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That did surprise me.
Mm-hmm.
But so Prime Day is going to be bigger than Black Friday. They'll have introduced deals as fast as every 10 minutes. I almost look like this as like a Woot off, but imagine Amazon's inventory.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I just can't imagine everything that they're going to have on sale.
Unreal.
And what would be interesting is, does this set a precedence and kind of almost overtake or overshadow what Black Friday brings? I'm looking forward to this, and I can't wait to see. Are we going to see leaks? Are we going to see like the Black Friday or the Amazon Prime Day like leaked pages?
Mm-hmm.
How quickly will they sell out of stuff? I don't know. I'm like I said, I'm definitely looking forward.
How many
to
people
this.
Are calling off work that day?
Well, and there's things that you could stack, right? Like here's your perfect chance if you want a Microsoft Office 365 bundled, like say they put a bundle for that on there, right?
Right.
Those are just keys. You
right.
can stack the keys. So they say they sold whatever a year costs. I'm just going to make up a number. So the one deal they were running for all, like all their services was what, like $150.
Mm-hmm.
Say they sell it for $50. You could buy 3 of them, stack them, and get 3 years for the price of one.
It's presuming. That's presuming what they do. They also don't put sales usually on digital keys. Like I've had this with the Xbox Live. They don't put a sale on, they retail the key that they send you. But if you buy the card, it's an item.
Mm-hmm.
So they can discount it.
Right.
And you get like $15 plus off of it. If you do that, and you'll get in 2 days of EF Prime. So,
right.
So, interesting stats to this, though. They're saying Prime members usually spend on average about $1,500. Non-Prime members usually about $625. So it's working. That $100 is worth it for that kind of thing. And this is basically you need to have a Prime membership to access the deals, it looks like. But you can go ahead and sign up for a 30-day trial right now. So basically anybody could really do this. So Yeah. So looking out for that, this will be the, you know, it's like a Steam sale, but with physical items.
I can't wait.
I mean, I can't wait to see what they have. I mean, yeah. I need, because we were talking about redoing the office, I need a new TV.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the things on my list to look at that day.
Ooh, yeah. I can get a TV to go with my new VCR.
I just gave Dutters a VCR and a stack of tapes. Well, you got other VHSs or something, right? Mm-hmm. So,
can't wait till you come to the Awesome Cast Cribs, my place.
There's our old TV.
She's gonna be our tech throwback Thursday Cribs.
There it is. All right, social media rundown. What do we got here?
Oh man, you got all kinds of stuff happening right now. Facebook changes. Here, I'm just going to go down things quickly for you. Facebook changes its algorithm. It's not just about popularity and shares. They're also looking at whether people are unmuting the videos and making them full screen. So
this has been very interesting lately. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what this means is if you're not watching videos, you're going to see less of them in your feed. Mm-hmm. But if you accidentally click on something and just out of curiosity, you're probably going to see more videos in your feed.
Yeah. Did you see the thing that they did too where they were – I saw something today and I just caught a glimpse of it where – Facebook's going to give you that YouTube-esque, like where on mobile devices where you can kind of keep it in a window, but you can go all over else wherever else on YouTube.
Okay,
they're doing something like that where it's going to be a floating video window.
Okay, fine.
If you want to keep the video playing, because you can kind of push it up and
that's something that because I'm like, oh, I actually want to check this video out, but I still want to keep reading, and now you can't resume the feed because you don't know if you're going to get the same feed. Mm-hmm. You know, no, I think that'd be really handy. Mm-hmm. Cool.
Sorry to interject.
Oh, you're jerk.
You're fired.
Get out. Twitter wants to know your birthday.
Okay.
Yeah, Twitter wants to know and give you balloons, but
they don't already know this?
No.
They don't give it that?
No. Nope.
Well, nope, they don't have it. You can choose to display it publicly with your followers or not at all. No matter what setting you choose, if you input your birthday, you're opening yourself up to a different search option because now you can limit your search to millennials, baby boomers. Wow. So
that's really what makes Facebook ads so strong is mm-hmm. the super, 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 super targeting that you can do over there.
So now Twitter's jumping in on that too.
Yep.
I don't know if you saw this yet. Facebook Messenger add person-to-person payments.
Yes.
So now you can send your...
The dollar sign keeps popping up in the corner, and I'm like, I'm going to hit that by accident. I already have a couple of times, and it's kind of annoying because I'm never going to set that up.
Snapchat got an update. I don't know if you've seen that lately. Mm-hmm. If you were like me, I was very confused on trying to hold the snaps down and why they weren't showing. Mm-hmm. Now it's just a touch. They've also added a, what's it called? Add nearby. If you have a group of friends who are on Snapchat and you all click the add nearby at the same time, you can add it as a group and you'll all be Snapchatting together. And okay. Also a two-factor authorization. So there's obviously seeing a lot more hacks.
Mm-hmm.
So they're kind of taking care of that. You'll like this. Oh, wait, never mind. Twitter mobile app. You'll like the next one. Twitter mobile app update allows you to purchase ads in-app. If you've updated the app on your phone, you'll notice that at the top. It looks like it's next to the analytics, so you think it's another analytic, but it's actually a Twitter ad purchaser.
Mm.
So you can do that on the mobile.
So if you're on the roll with that, okay. Mm-hmm. They want to make it way, way too easy at this point. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm always... Not to get too deep in the social media side, but I don't think like boosting your post or boosting your tweet, promoting your tweet should be a fly by night thing. But I think they're trying to make it that to, you know, make you spend more money with it, obviously. But mm-hmm. I don't think anybody should be mm-hmm. unless they are already deep, deep, deep in this already. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, normal people get this too, don't they?
Yeah.
So I'm just a person tweeting about American Idol, and it says, oh, you get a lot of response, go and boost this. Mm-hmm. And you're like, okay, you know, I don't know. I think you're kind of, because you do you get boost posts when you're not attached to pages?
Oh, yeah.
You do?
You can boost.
Really?
Yeah.
So I thought it was just since I have so many pages, like I just get that stuff and I get like, I'm starting to get this is what your ad would look like, even though it would never approve it for whatever reason, like mm-hmm. my image is too small or something. It's kind of getting annoying, Facebook. Mm-hmm. I wish there was a, hey, I will never buy anything on you. I'm a consumer.
you know, kind of mode to it. Or maybe I'm just getting it more because I do have the pages and it knows it's something I can market. They can market me. So.
And finally, Instagram is finally increasing its photo resolution. Yay! Because everybody who had the iPhone 6 Plus angry.
Oh, no.
Because they look kind of ugly.
And I didn't realize they only did 640 by 640 before.
Now you're getting our 1080p.
1080.
Yeah, I've taken a couple of those and tried using them for like Twitter cover art, and it stretches out across the screen. It's like, ooh, that is not good.
Well, I was reading somewhere where they did actually keep a lot of the high def,
mm-hmm.
or the higher, I probably shouldn't say high def, but the higher quality images when you uploaded them. So I don't know if they're going to go back and retrofit the older photos, or if you're just stuck with what you got and it's only 1080 by 1080 going
forward.
I
don't think there's a lot of historical, like, I don't think there's a lot of going back on Instagram. Do you think?
I don't know. I do find myself, like, if I meet someone or start talking to someone, I will go back through their feed.
Yeah.
As well as I'm the casual Instagrammer.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm the person that's probably more apt to go on there like once a week and mm-hmm. go find who I'm looking for and look back through their feed.
Okay.
I think this is also good, obviously, as more and more users are probably navigating via a laptop
mm-hmm.
or tablet. This is probably a long-awaited change.
Awesome.
Yeah, they said it took them, 10 months to roll it out since the iPhone 6 mm-hmm. Plus came out? So they were surprised.
Yeah, we're almost on the next iPhone.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
7S Plus.
But I think Plus. even though they're with Facebook, I think the word is they're still kind of a small team.
Oh, I'm sure they are.
There. And they're not terribly. Yeah, they're not.
But you're literally changing a pixel number. We're not talking
about that's true.
Here.
I guess so. Yes.
It's
but that could break like a million users. You know what I mean?
But the screen resolution, it's still going to be square.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I can't imagine the file size being... I mean, we're not talking... worrying about people on 9600 baud modems trying to download a file that's four times the size. I just don't see why they can't... why this would be that big of a deal. And also, if they have the back catalog already in a higher definition file to upscale all of them.
Mm-hmm.
Because to your point, if you want to reuse your Instagram photo on Twitter, it looks like crap.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right. All right. Who put this in here that I'm completely putting on my wish list now? this palette.
The modular.
Controller. By the way, the video sucks because they show photographer doing photography things in the last like 20 seconds of it. They actually show the device. Okay. So I'll have a little bit to show here. What is the deal with palette? And when am I getting it to use with Wirecast here?
Yes!
It does look like it. I clicked the wrong thing. I actually did accidentally pull up the porn earlier. thankfully, I didn't switch the camera. But what is this thing?
So it's actually, if you're familiar with, what do they call it? Aria from Google, that's the modular phone.
Okay.
This is like a modular control panel and it looks like they're going to support a ton of applications. You can see here in the video, they're doing a lot with photo editing.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to be able to assign everything to these buttons and sliders and dials.
So this is the thing I want for live switching on Wirecast.
Exactly.
So this will work with anything? Like, it was saying about how it's really good if you thrive in Adobe products.
Yeah, I'm guessing they're going to... It seems like Adobe has an easy, customizable plug-in piece where they can probably write to that first.
Mm-hmm.
I can't imagine that they're going to keep it just for that. You can see they're doing it in Premiere. I'm sure there's going to be something for the more experienced people like us that are going to be able to let us map it to either keyboard commands or whatever. So I don't know. I see this for people, especially like you, that do video or people that do audio or whatever,
mm-hmm.
Being able to customize your own switchboard.
Because I mean, one of the things I'm looking at, I'm seriously looking into the idea of taking a laptop, putting Wirecast on it, and that's what we live switch for, like HD video. Mm-hmm. I haven't figured out entirely what I need to do for the input outputs for it. And I'm looking into some boxes, and I had some that didn't really work out, and what do we do for cord and stuff. But and that always works, because I use a keyboard here to do the switches like that, you know. Mm-hmm. And it'd be nice to have, you know, it'd be nice to have that thing I can set up like this guy does in the video. He's at a photo shoot, and he sets it up, plugs the things in and everything. And I have something that I don't have to worry about hitting something else in the middle of a live wrestling production and mm-hmm. just lose everything, right? I mean, of course, we do redundancies upon redundancies otherwise, but still, you really want to make sure you're covered with that. And just this is a deep consideration for something like that, to be able to do something like that. And I don't know, buttons for tile or for titles and stuff like that. I mean, I think it's completely possible there. So I like it. I like it. I put it on my Pinterest board, because I learned how to use Pinterest after last week's social media day. But anyways, so with that, we got to get out here so the guys can talk video games over on Bass Battle. It's a fishing podcast, apparently. Bass Battle.
My dad has the Wiimote, the Wii controller for the fishing rod.
Oh, no. They had one of those for the Dreamcast. But anyways, anything else? I don't know. I don't really have anything for stuff going on. PodCamp Pittsburgh sessions are up. I may be attached to three of them already. AwesomeCast Live is currently slated for the Saturday, but I have a feeling it's going to move to the Sunday, to be quite honest. Very excited about that. Very excited talking with some names coming back to PodCamp. Back to PodCamp. I got 100% sure in talking with him about a session. I got another pretty big name saying he's 80% sure he will be there. So there's some inside info for you there. Very excited about that. And I know there'll be some other familiar faces there as well. PodCamp Pittsburgh.com for that. Chachi plays Strong Rolling. We actually recorded the other day, and hopefully the video will be up very soon, if I get the chance to capture it. With Yajagoff, we talked with him about Chachi Plays. ChachiPlays.com. And you can donate and become part of the Mario Kart, Tetris, or Street Fighter tournament, I think, is the other one. It's for some really good arts programs for underprivileged kids in the Pittsburgh area. And we'll be doing the live stream that weekend as well. And anything else going on you guys want
to... Amazon Prime Day.
Amazon Prime Day. It's all about, it's all about Amazon Prime Day. I mean, this is going to be like a Amazon Prime preview show next week.
Windows 10 is claiming to go RTM by end of week and be available to the public at the end of the month.
Yes,
the 27th.
You may not get it. I thought it was the 29th. Maybe because you may not get it the first day, depending on where you are in line. They say Enterprise is getting it first. There was some discussion about that. I could be wrong on that, but that's a discussion that I overheard. So on a podcast I eavesdropped on. I don't know, but anyways. At Chilla on the Twitters.
That's where you can find me. John's yes. Chilla on the Facebooks.
Yes, in his tech throwbacks going on over there. At K Dutters on the Twitters.
I'm watching Stadium Worker eaten by tarp at PNC Park.
What? Somebody periscoping this or something?
No, apparently it's the game. There was there's a storm outside.
Yeah, I saw one of my co-hosts says he'll be late. There's no power. So yeah. Apparently something is going on. We were having brownouts during this show, but we survived. We'll see if everybody else is alive out there for boss battle. So, all right, guys. Thanks. Check us out. AwesomeCast.net. Please subscribe to us. Check out the Patreon.com/AwesomeCast. We got links down there for things that we talked about. I'll probably try to stick that book in there as well that we talked about earlier in the show and other items that are purchasable. Please, if you're going to purchase them, click on the Amazon link so we can get a little bit of a kickback to help support the show. You're going to get it anyways. That's why you listen, for those good pointers and stuff here, right? What?
The tarp is now trending in Pittsburgh.
Oh, geez. So with that, thanks a lot. And thanks to our awesome chat room that's been in there all night. I'm very limited, so I haven't been all over it. So sorry, guys. So you've been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.